Again, I am Chris Ward. I am delighted to welcome our panel. I'm not going to do introductions. Everybody, I think, has their background information. What I am going to do is just quickly set the stage, and then we'll go down from my right to the left and allow each one of our panelists to speak on the topic, and then we will again be open for questions. I once gave brief remarks at the Regional Plan Association, and I said one of the primary challenges that we face in thinking about our working waterfront is a sense of nostalgia, that we are often prisoners of what we thought we knew, and that we have failed to recognize that the working waterfront is in fact an incredibly dynamic, changing industry that, as we've seen, moving from Manhattan to Brooklyn to New Jersey with other waterfront activity following in behind it. And that as long as we continue to think that it's only defined by the past, we will lose the opportunity to capture perhaps an even brighter future. And today's panel, looking at a variety of perspectives from fundamentally, how do we create jobs on the waterfront, but also what are the transportation benefits? How does utilization of our waterfront aid our environment? So what I'd like to do is really ask Kevin Corbett to set the stage for us and give us some brief history, which might have a touch of nostalgia to it, given Kevin's long history with the shipping industry, but also give us a sense of the dynamic changes. And then Congressman Nadler, who I introduced this morning as perhaps one of the leading, if not the leading, figure in terms of thinking about our working waterfront, to follow on from Kevin, and then we'll move down the panel. So Kevin, take it away.
Great. Thank you, Chris. Good morning. Thanks. Great turnout here, as always. The MWA does a fantastic job. Okay, you want to stand up? I think if we look at preserving blue-collar jobs, first I would like to, of all people, we have a great panel, but particularly Congressman Nadler, if you talk about somebody who has understood and supported the industry for decades and also has a vision to do, big things and great things. You know, we have an era with transportation infrastructure generally where we can't get out of our own way sometimes, and it's great that we have Jerry as such a strong advocate and visionary. I think on the blue-collar job front, a little bit of a history and nostalgia. I hate to admit that I'm old enough to remember when this was still working waterfront and they had the elevated Miller Highway. And I think just the historic context of where shipping went in as far as working waterfront and the blue-collar jobs, the days where there were 60,000 longshoremen and it walked to work from the surrounding neighborhood has long gone. And there was a lot of reasons, and that just didn't happen overnight. In the 60s, you saw the industry leave Manhattan and going to Newark, going to Brooklyn, more McCormick, 23rd Street. And a lot of those were not yet container ships. There were some containers on the decks, but they were old conventional kind of loading over the side with cranes on the ship with various hatches. And, very inefficient, but that was, you could take anything. You could put a bus on it, you could put wine, kegs, or boxes of goods. And what you start seeing in the 70s was specialization. As Manhattan was starting, was desolate waterfront, but even in New Jersey where the container terminals, they started as containerization started to take hold there. But you also had product carriers. You see, New York, New Jersey is the largest oil port in the country. And that's, private sector. But you see special commodities like orange juice now goes in special ships that are just, liquid bulk. You have roll-on, roll-off ships where all the cars and trucks and Caterpillar tractors come on and off. And so as you got into specialization, the facilities also became specialized. The one that gets the most notoriety, of course, is one of the most, controversial on the New York side, certainly, is what do you do with the container, the regular container commercial traffic? And, 30 years ago, a container ship that could carry 2,000 20-foot containers was considered large. Nowadays, you're talking, 20,000 containers and more. So the scale and the size of these ships is like instead of having a little dribble from your sink, you now have a fire hose gushing in large volumes of commercial cargo on these container ships. And that has caused a ripple effect all the way down through the logistics chain from railroad, intermodal yards, and the space that's needed for that. But also, vis-a-vis our topic here, it really has changed the labor equivalent as it becomes more and more financially capital intensive. You're going to, as industry is pumping billions of dollars into cranes and ships and all the related infrastructure, they are trying to be as efficient as possible in labor. And it's an economic development challenge, you know, for any state official or government official dealing with economic development, is that the trend in industry is actually to do more investment. We want companies to invest, but the same token, those investments are geared to reducing the workforce. And an example a bit different, but you know, the state of New York, General Motors has a big engine plant up in Tonawanda, New York, outside Buffalo. And the state gave incentives to significantly reduce the number of jobs there. The alternative was they would move out of state and shut down the plant. So you see that in the, you know, I think for a lot of the container terminals where you used to have thousands of longshoremen, you now, you know, can see the ideal for a lot of the shipping lines is to have two men and a dog, and it's all being run by computers, you know, 50 miles inland, you know, with AV equipment. So the romantic image that Chris talked on versus the economic realities and drivers that you see in ports like Singapore, Hong Kong, Dubai, Hamburg, that is a very different image than what a lot of people are thinking today. That being said, when we talk about blue-collar jobs, what really it kills a lot of us, and I don't know where Andrew Genn is, and saw Meg Black earlier, but if you look at the related industries, the tug, the barge, warehouse distribution jobs, even the schools, you know, people don't think of us as a education center for the maritime industry. You have Kings Point, you have SUNY Maritime, Fort Schuyler, you have the Harbor School, you have the Urban Assembly School of Global Commerce. So there are a lot of activity that is, we have the workforce here that we can supply. We have tens of thousands of jobs that are needed as the aging workforce on all these various waterfront aspects, ship chandlers, freight forwarders, there's a whole industry. That is here. New York is a great center. We are still one of the largest centers for that activity. And we need to really capitalize that and get a higher visibility. You know, Wall Street, people know about Wall Street or real estate or, you know, Google. But for a lot of New Yorkers and people around this area, particularly those from disadvantaged backgrounds, one of the best ways, if you're not going to be a PhD from MIT, not that I'm saying there's anything wrong with those guys, but, you know, may not want to date them. But that's what I told my daughter anyway. But you know, those, if you look at a lot of the jobs, there are a lot of jobs here, and we need to, you know, get the workforce geared for that. But I think we first have to have community buy-in of what we want on our various waterfront, and we need to have both private and public sector and a vision and support from particularly the city, but the city, the states, and the port authority to really make it a reality. And hopefully that's it, and we'll have questions later.
Great. Thank you, Kevin. So again, thank you, Kevin. Setting the stage, we see Time's Arrow moving in a variety of directions. We've seen increasing specialization technology driving down jobs and containerization, but we've seen support services grow. We've seen ferries grow, but we've also seen the region grow, and we've also seen transportation challenges being posed by how does a consuming region, in fact, feed itself? How does it fuel itself? How does that waterfront growth capture an economic future that has been so vibrant, but that is obviously changing? And with that, his now third introduction is Congressman Nadler and his vision for the waterfront. Thank you, Congressman.
Well, thank you very much. Let me say, I'm going to have to apologize in advance because I just got a call to something I'm going to have to be at 12:15, so I'm going to have to leave here by 11:45. Let me say that it's an exciting time now because people are beginning to finally realize that we have to have a port on both sides of the harbor. And things are changing. The Panama Canal is being widened. It should be open next year. The ships are getting much bigger. You're even going to have post-Panamax ships that won't fit in the widened Panama Canal. And the traffic is growing. Back in 1999, the New York City and the New York City EDC and the Port Authority did a port planning study, and they predicted that the port, which was then doing about 2.5 million TEUs, that a TEU is a 20-foot equivalent unit, so one 20-foot container is one TEU, one 40-foot container is two TEUs. It's then doing about 2.5 million TEUs. They predicted that that if we became the hub port on the Eastern Seaboard, which we should, that by 2020, we'd be doing 10 million TEUs, and by 2040, 14 to 17 million. It's now about 15 years later, we're way ahead of the curve of where they thought we would be. So you can predict that 10 million figure for 2000 and that 14 to 17 million figure for 2040 is probably on the low end or lower. That means we're going to need all the acreage we can have in ports. Our port now, with the exception of Red Hook, which is a very small container port, the port now is Port Newark, Port Elizabeth, and Howland Hook. Port Newark and Port Elizabeth and Howland Hook are all in Newark Bay. Actually, Howland Hook is on the Arthur Kill, but the other two ports are on Newark Bay, not New York Harbor. Newark Bay is separated from New York Harbor by the Kill Van Cull. The Kill Van Cull is a narrow, treacherous body of water separating Staten Island on the south, Bayonne on the north. It's only 800 yards wide. It's also difficult to navigate for a bigger ship because you have to veer, make a sharp right turn to avoid an island called Shooter's Island. Now, as the ships get bigger, that navigation gets trickier. We have to have, and what I've been saying for a long time, and I think people are getting to realize this, is we have to have a major container port on both sides of the harbor, in Brooklyn as well as in New Jersey. Not just for the obvious benefit that New York is a separate polity from New Jersey, why shouldn't we get tax revenues and employment and so forth too, but because of economic factors. And there are a number of economic factors. One is that two-thirds of the market for goods is east of the river, east of the harbor. That means that everything that comes into the harbor that goes to those ports on the other side and that is destined for this side has to be trucked across. That trucking is expensive, and it also screws up the George Washington Bridge, our highways, et cetera. Second of all, it's a national security problem. 93% of all the goods coming into New York City, Long Island, Westchester, and Southern Connecticut come in over the George Washington Bridge. 93%. You shut down that bridge for a couple of days, and all it takes is a couple of phone calls to the FBI warning them of some non-existent threat, and they'll shut it down by inspecting everything. And that's happened for one day so far, a few times. It could happen for a few days. But the fact is, it's a national security threat. You have to have an ability to land stuff on this side of the harbor, and you have to have redundancy in any vital transportation facility. Thirdly, you probably are simply not going to have enough acreage in the ports without Brooklyn also. Now, the 1999 port study was adopted in 1999. There was an agreement reached in 1999 by the Giuliani administration, by all the elected officials in that part of Brooklyn, and by the community board. It was immortalized in the port principles and in the community board's 197A, section 197A of the city charter, development plan, that we would develop a 300-acre container port over a 30-year period in Sunset Park, stretching essentially from 29th Street to 65th Street, except for a park in the middle. We've constructed the park. It was opened a few months ago. We haven't constructed the port, but it would be centered on South Brooklyn Marine Terminal. The Giuliani administration really abandoned that. Not the Giuliani. He was pretty good on it, actually. The Bloomberg administration essentially abandoned that. They gave lip service to it, but they did nothing for it. The de Blasio administration seems interested again and is, in fact, being interested. There have been discussions going on between my office, Councilman Menchaca's office, Nydia Velasquez, local community people, and the city and the city council about coming to an agreement for initial development for a long-term lease with various conditions of the of SBMT, South Brooklyn Marine Terminal, to begin development of a major container facility and allied things. And those discussions there's almost an agreement, and that looks very good at this point. Let me say a couple of other things. You have some other necessities for a port, for a major working port here, too. And one of the things is that these ships are getting much bigger. As the ships get much bigger, the Kill Van Cull gets comparatively much smaller. You have one accident in the Kill Van Cull and have a major ship run aground there, you could shut the port for months, maybe a year. That's a real risk, and it's getting more risky as the ships get bigger. We have to have, again, redundancy. You have to have a port that isn't on the wrong side of the Kill Van Cull. And that's another national security issue. So these are some reasons why we have to have a major port in Brooklyn, in addition to the obvious employment tax issues. Secondly, you've got a different problem now. And this is allied. It's been examined separately, but it's really allied. And that's the whole question of goods movement into New York City and Long Island. We are the only city in North America where everything comes in by truck. In the United States as a whole, intercity freight, about 43% of intercity freight goes by rail. In New York, Long Island, Westchester, Putnam, Southern Connecticut, the figure is about 1%. Everything comes in by truck. Everything comes in by truck over the GW Bridge, as I mentioned before. That's a national security problem. It's also, it makes things much more expensive here than necessary. If you assume an economic growth rate of 2% a year, 2.0% a year, the amount of freight by volume coming into geographic Long Island is going to increase by 37% in the next 20 years. If you assume 2.75%, which we would normally say is a rather modest figure, it's going to increase by 80%. Where are you going to put it? You don't have enough highways, and you can't build more highways. We're paved over. And the answer is you have to build a rail freight tunnel under the harbor. We're making progress on that, too. And the rail freight tunnel under the harbor also gives you very good access for the port. These two projects together complement each other, and it also means that the warehousing, right now a lot of the stuff that comes in, let's say it comes in from Asia, comes by ship to Los Angeles or Oakland, Long Beach rather, not Oakland, comes by rail across the country, gets put on trucks in New Jersey and trucked in here. Norfolk Southern and CSX are building major rail centers in Allentown and Harrisburg that are going to replace to a large extent the terminals in New Jersey, which means that if nothing is done, the entire width of New Jersey on I-78 is going to become a parking lot. And it's going to increase the cost of goods here and the cost to our economy greatly, which is going to happen anyway as the system gets overburdened by more goods. So if you have the rail freight tunnel, stuff can come straight in by rail to a port or from a port. If the stuff comes to the port and is going to Eastern, to Long Island or to New York, put it right by on a shuttle rail to Brookhaven or to wherever. If it's going inland, it can go the other way. In addition to which, the bigger ships, some of them are going to, it's going to become, apparently, it looks like it's going to become very economical to avoid the Panama Canal entirely, especially from Southern Asia, as trade ships to Southern Asia, not China, and come around the Cape and go directly to an East Coast port. And that will give a lot more volume to New York and increase the necessity of our having the capacity on the Brooklyn port as well. Now, there has been a lot of ignorant talk by some people that we should close the port at Red Hook. It's a small port, doesn't do that much business, and after all, if you closed it, it's valuable real estate, and you could sell it. It could become condos or this or that or whatever. We must not do that, period. Maybe you could make a case for doing that once you have a full-fledged container operation in Sunset Port. In Sunset Park, but once you close the existing small port operation in Brooklyn, the business will go to New Jersey and it'll be very hard to get back. And it'll make it much harder to establish what we have to do here. So we've been saying you can't do that either. It's a very short-sighted thing. You have to have a balanced port, and there is tremendous pressure. There's been tremendous pressure for 30 years to take all our rail assets, our port assets, our industrial assets that's old-fashioned, let's make them golf courses, let's make them condos, let's make them, you know, gentrification, whatever. The fact is we have, and I can never remember this figure, we have either 751 miles or 571 miles. One of those is the total mileage of the subway system. The other is the total amount of waterfront in New York. We need 3.5 of those miles for maritime use. And we ought to be able to keep that and have and sustain an economy on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Congressman. And this is a perfect segue to Clay Maitland, who is the managing partner at International Registries, who has a deep understanding of the very issues that Congressman Nadler was referring to in terms of the ship profiles and the ships that are currently registered on and are going to be registered plying the international waters. Clay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the introduction. To give you a little bit of perspective, International Registry sounds very blah. We're the Marshall Islands Ship Registry. That was one of our ships that got detained, as we like to say, in
Clay,
Iran.
Clay, sorry, is your mic on?
Should be.
A little closer, Clay.
I'm not usually difficult to hear. Thank you. My company runs the Marshall Islands Ship Registry, which is the third largest in the world. That was a Marshall Islands ship that was detained in Iran, and I think it's going to be released finally today or tomorrow, it looks like it. So we have a very big global shipping presence. That said, if you fly into New York on the shuttle, you've heard Congressman Nadler and a number of other people allude to the fact that merchant shipping, ships that carry cargoes, are kind of out of sight. If you look outside the windows of this ship right now, you don't see any merchant ships. But if you fly over the Verrazano Bridge, you see a whole lot of them approaching the port of New York and New Jersey, and you see a whole lot of them lined up to go into the kills that Congressman Nadler was referring to a few minutes ago. They're headed for Port Newark, Port Elizabeth, the big container terminal. Some are going to Red Hook. Some are going, and this is what I want to touch on a little bit, to a terminal at Carteret, New Jersey, which is at the north end of the kills, the far end, really across from Staten Island. Carteret is a little-known community, mostly of Ukrainian and Polish Americans, which is, you pass it on the way to Newark Airport. You see the sign. Most people don't realize that that's one of the major ports or terminals in the world for chemical cargoes. Cargoes that are basically made as a product or byproduct of the refinement of petroleum. There are other sources too, but those go in here. The reason I refer to Carteret is that New York, among its many attributes, is one of the world's great transshipment ports. Stuff comes in here. We're not talking about coat hangers with Made in China printed on them. We're talking about product that goes into the manufacture of almost everything you see around you right here on the Hornblower Infinity. These are chemicals. The chemicals are always going to be processed somewhere into something else. Of all the ports in the United States, that port in Carteret is absolutely essential as a transshipment port. It is also one of the major focal points for what we're talking about here today, which is jobs. Jobs and the training of people. I'm on the board of a little harbor school, not the one we're going to talk about in a minute, but the harbor school in Baltimore. And we've been reading about Baltimore lately. Baltimore lost its port infrastructure. It lost its jobs. If you've been reading the papers lately, you probably realize that that's one of the reasons why there is so much unemployment in Baltimore, and why we have, touch wood, not had that problem in New York, and I say yet. I hope we don't. Maritime jobs in a major port like New York and New Jersey, or in a major port like Baltimore, which is a deeper water port than New York, are absolutely essential for the employment of people who come from schools and backgrounds in our inner city. And my friend Captain Delaney is going to talk about that in a few minutes, I trust. But what I'm going to say is that from the commercial standpoint, from the private sector standpoint, these various elements and building blocks of our port, which include facilities like Carteret, tank farms in New Jersey, the things you pass by but you don't know what's in them, those are very, very important to the economic future of our entire region. Now, I'd like to say, before I shut up, I'm going to say one thing about what we call short sea shipping, which is a rather odd term that has become popular in recent years. We suffer from, as you've heard this morning, a dramatic transportation crisis in New York. Anyone who tried to get here, to get on this boat, realizes how difficult it is to get around New York or the greater New York area by land. The solution, as has been pointed out, is to move people by water. That's the one great area that has not been fully developed. But it is also true that a lot of the cargo, and I've been talking about transshipment, has to move by water as well. In the early years of this century and the late 19th century, if you go into the museums and, or into some of the older buildings around here, you will see photographs of New York Harbor, meaning the lower bay, the upper bay, lower Manhattan, and it's full of watercraft. Those watercraft were car floats moving rail cars across the harbor. They were moving cargoes. There were factories across the across in New Jersey, and ferries moved employees back and forth. But mostly, they were moving cargo. Some of it bulk cargo, like grain, some of it coal, ice, all of the things that were the basic building blocks of the mercantile business of the city in those days. We got away from there. As Congressman Nadler very eloquently said just now, we're dependent on trucks, which is absolutely ridiculous, because we ought to be moving the great bulk of what's coming across the harbor, through the harbor, and is being transshipped from the harbor by tug and barge. We're not talking about people now. We're talking about the products and the cargoes that are coming into places like Carteret, that are going into the container terminals. The way to move those out of New York once they get into this port is by tug and barge. Why is that relevant to what we're talking about here? Because my mother started a charity, a very small charity, her name was Virginia, so it's Virginia's House of Hope. It trains inner city kids in waterfront work. These are kids who may or may not be high school graduates. They come out of the inner city of New York and New Jersey, mostly New York, mostly the Bronx and Brooklyn, some Manhattan, and they get into Vane Brothers, McAllister, Moran, the various towing companies, give them apprenticeships. It's a very small program, but it feeds into Captain Delernia's operation. It feeds into Fort Schuyler, which is SUNY Maritime in the Bronx. I'm going to be quiet now, but I'm going to ask for a show of hands. How many of you are aware of the fact that the State University of New York has a maritime college? Good. It's the oldest one in the nation, founded in 1874. How many of you are aware of the fact that the Federal Maritime Academy is in Great Neck, at Kings Point? That's interesting. Much fewer showing hands. Those are the two principal educational institutions for training of ocean-going seafarers, and they're both in the New York area or in New York City. I'm going to be quiet now because I think you've had enough. Yeah. Well, I should have run for office. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Clay. Thank you very much.
When Roland called me and said, he asked for a topic, and I gave him the topic on the waterfront. Great. Thank you. Can I put this here? Yeah. Because I'd like to stand up and see everybody. I don't want to hide. I gave him a topic, and he said, great. He called me and said, Tony, we accepted your topic, and we're going to run with it. I said, great. He said, we want you to be part of the panel. I said, wonderful. Thank you very much. And I said, can I show PowerPoints? He said, no. I said, okay. I said, how much time do I have? He said, 6.5 minutes. I said, what? He said, 6.5 minutes. So here's going to be my 6.5 minutes, perhaps a little bit longer, although Clay did take half of my presentation in his presentation. My name's Tony DeLernia. I am the Director of Maritime Technology at Kingsborough Community College, which is a unit of the City University of New York. And I like to call our program the Unknown Maritime Program. Clay mentioned earlier that New York City is host to two of the finest maritime institutions in the country, SUNY Maritime and the United States Merchant Marine Academy at Kings Point. Both of those institutions train men and women for careers at sea, specifically for what we call the Blue Water Fleet, transocean, big ships. When in 1986, we started a maritime program. We actually started a commercial fishing program at Kingsborough Community College, which was supposed to, at that time, support what was going to be Fishport in Brooklyn. By 1991, we had made the decision at Kingsborough that a commercial fishing program was not a good way to go, and we created a boating program. Well, by 2000, we realized that we really had to do something different. And what we did was we converted that boating program into a program designed to train men and women for careers in the brown water fleet. Not the big ocean boats, but the brown water fleet. And the reason we did that was we looked at the statistics as far as where growth was concerned. Break bulk cargo ships were disappearing. Ships that carried 30 and 40 men and a crew were gone. Container ships with the cargo, with the crews of maybe 10 or 12 was what was becoming the norm. But there was a growth area in the U.S. maritime industry that was not being served by the blue water academies, and that was the brown water fleet, tug and barge, transportation. All morning today, we have heard about the ferry system in New York Harbor and how it's come into existence and how it's growing. Who runs those ferries? Our graduates from Kingsburg Community College. Who will run the future ferries and the future dinner boats? Well, the crew of this boat, when this boat sails today, many of the crewmen will be graduates of our maritime program at Kingsburg Community College. What we did was when we developed our maritime program, our brown water program, we looked at what was a crew going to look like for a brown water boat, a ferry, a tug, a dinner boat. And we realized that the traditional training of either deck or engineering was not going to lend itself very well to the brown water fleet. So when we developed the curriculum, we developed the curriculum that combined both deck and engineering skills. Our graduates, our students engage in basic seamanship and navigation, electronic navigation and radar. They take courses in safety and survival. But they also take courses in diesel engine and gasoline engines. We have an extensive program that they have to complete in welding. You bang up a ferry boat between the morning and afternoon runs, our graduates can fix it, fix the rails, fix the doorways, and get that boat back into service before the evening run is ready to go. Our graduates take courses in, our students take courses in electrical systems. I already mentioned marine electronics. They have their CPR, they have their first aid. When we graduate our students, and by the way, we do not have a very large program, because our program is designed to be 50% classroom, 50% hands-on. Our labs, our shoreside labs, have no more than 12 students in them, or a class will have no more than 12 students in it. A on-the-water class, such as a boat handling class, of which you get extensive experience in, has no more than 6 students in it. So the commitment of City University to the program financially is significant. We only accept about 36 students a year. And so that's why I like to say we are, in a sense, an unknown program, because we fill every seat every year without having to run out and say, look, here we are, this is what we do. Enough people know about us, and we take our students and we place them in jobs. And I'm proud to say that once they get those jobs, they perform well, they represent us well, and the employers then come back and say to us, we want more of your graduates. When I first proposed this discussion panel, I wanted it to be a dialogue between maritime training institutions and employers. We need to know, I need to know, as I review my curriculum every year, and we come up for our Coast Guard approvals every 5 years, I need to know what the employers in the harbor need from our graduates, so that I make sure that our program serves those needs, gives them, our students, employable skills. They graduate with an associate's degree. If they want to, they can continue on to a 4-year institution, or they can go to work. So later on during the question and answers, if some folks would like to offer suggestions as to areas where we think, where they think our students, if you know our students or our graduates, may benefit from additional training skills, I would love to hear from you. Also, one final thing, our program, we meet each year with our industry advisors, and we create, again, a dialogue between the advisors and our teachers, our professors. And we say, what do you want them to know? Have things changed since the past year? If anyone's ever interested in serving on board our advisory panels, please contact me at Kingsburg Community College. I'll be very happy to speak with you and to find a place for you. I hope I did it under 6 minutes. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. You didn't keep it under 6 minutes, but that was a great presentation.
Last, I'm pleased to introduce Councilman Menchaca, and in some respects, must respond and answer to the whole variety of issues that have just been presented. Obviously, a community which is facing economic challenges for job creation, facing community planning issues in terms of what is the right activity to take place in and around Sunset Park, facing the issues of the green space available to the community, and really as someone who's been at the forefront of leading that community dialogue and trying as an elected official to stitch all of these issues together, if I could ask him to speak and respond to so much that you heard at the panel today.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ward, and thank you, MWA, for putting this conference on. It's such an important community to engage on such variety of issues. And as the council member representing the 38th District, which includes Red Hook and Sunset Park, a very rich part of the multi-mile stretch of waterfront in this community, I really feel like so many of the issues that the city is facing and the questions that you just kind of heard today are all happening in Sunset Park and Red Hook. And so very quickly, I want to really do a couple touch points on some of the issues and the questions that we're asking in the district. But before I do that, really, this is happening at a moment in time. The dynamic nature of government, the dynamic nature of industry, the dynamic nature of what we are defining as a progressive agenda in the city is all coming together. And it's a beautiful time, I think, for us to continue to engage and build bridges. But this is happening over a historical length of time of advocacy from our congressman, who continues to be a mentor for me on thinking about these big questions, to the industries itself. And so I just want to honor that. There's also been a lot of conversation in the community through 197A plans that currently exist and offer that kind of support to the maritime industry. And really, this is what we're building this next chapter in. So really quick, I want to offer a couple pieces of direct kind of connection to some of the things that we're talking about. One is, I think that the city has been looking at a lot of these places in silos, and they're not making the connections within a community, within the city, and this is why the congressman is absolutely right, that we need to think about both sides of the harbor as solutions, and what's happening in Sunset Park continues to be divided, and what we're doing right now in some really new chapters after some deep conversations with the Economic Development Corporation is that they're really making some changes to start connecting the dots between the city-owned property, which is significant in Sunset Park, and the rest of the industrial, manufacturing, maritime property around it. And really, as the pressures of population grow, as the pressures of housing grow with some major demands from the mayor, what we're trying to do is figure out how do we reconcile all that, not as one site, but as the entire district. And so that's something that we're already moving in. Very quickly, I want to say that the Economic Development Corporation is restructuring their entire agency to bring boots on the ground in Sunset Park to be able to talk about the relationships with all their city property and really offer that connection to our questions. We also have a new park. Show of hands, how many of you have been to Bush Terminal Park? Raise your hand. Great. Okay. Wonderful. Not as many hands as before. And so we want you to get out there and look at that, because we want your eyes to understand what we're going to be dealing with. This park just opened in the fall. This has been a almost 20 year struggle for this community to build this park. And so as we think about the port that's coming at SBMT, which we are committed to activating, and that core commitment has been very clear from the beginning. The questions were how we were going to do it. And so as we move to activate the SBMT component and think about the jobs that are coming and think about connecting the immigrant community that many times are foreign-born, don't speak English, have a lot of skills, but need that bridge to Kingsborough and other, and the SUNY Maritime program, we need to make sure that is strong. And so these are the things, as a council member, we're trying to figure out how we connect all those pieces together. We also have to protect the land use. And as the council member, I have a huge role in making that commitment. And I've made that commitment from the very beginning, probably one of my big first letters to the city was to protect the industrial working waterfront. And so that continues to be a commitment for me as we move forward. But we got to do that. And we want to make sure that the administration is with us on that front. Because once we lose these pieces of property for what we are all talking about, maritime, industrial, we lose them forever. They become extinct. We don't get them back. And that's why even Red Hook needs to be protected at its fullest, and the Red Hook terminal needs to be protected. And I would even say until some kind of miracle allows us all in this room to think that we can lose that port too, we want to protect that as well. We also want to think about how the community interacts with our waterfronts in ways that are not industrial. And those are ferry services. We talked about ferries, open space. We're working with organizations like the MWA and Portside, for example, in Red Hook, where we're trying to solve some real critical issues for access, because these are ways that our young people, and I recently went on a trip, a field trip with some kids, young people looking at and going through the Mary Wayland and just seeing for the first time. That kernel of opportunity happens at an elementary level where they can start thinking about careers. That doesn't happen when they're in high school and they are on another track. That happens when they're young. We need to have that part of this solution as well. But that presents some balancing acts here on bringing the port, bringing open space, bringing ferry access, bringing educational opportunities, and this is not easy. And so I just welcome the opportunity to continue to work with you all and learn more. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think, Congressman, you said you needed to... okay, well, let me ask you, Congressman Nedler, a tough question. You heard the councilman speak about weaving all these many themes together, and I once had a public policy course when I was in graduate school that said if you had 7 outcomes you were trying to achieve and you had more than 3 inputs per outcome, it becomes statistically impossible to achieve your 7 outcomes. And given what the councilman just gave us, I wonder if we're facing that potential challenge, and that there are so many outcomes we need in Brooklyn that they all can't be achieved. And if they can't be, how do we begin through that community process establishing priorities?
That's the question.
Well, I don't think we have that many different outcomes. There seems to be a pretty good consensus, and the councilman has been very good at helping achieve this, and Congresswoman Velasquez and the community people and some of the other elected officials. There's local consensus that we don't want gentrification, which is shorthand for housing and other things in some of those areas. We want industrial and maritime use. There will be some differences on exactly what industrial and what maritime and exactly where, but those are issues that can be worked out. And I'm very hopeful about, and now that we have a mayoral administration that seems to be very interested in this, I'm very hopeful that we'll be able to achieve this. You know, one of the problems we had was we actually had Hanjin Lines about 10 years ago, came in and offered to put in a huge amount, several billion dollars of private money to develop port facilities there, and the mayoral administration at that time was not willing to even meet with them. We have a very different situation now. I do think that the economic imperative there is so great that we will probably get considerable interest, and it may take some politicking, by which I mean talking and so forth, but I do think we have a very good shot at doing this. And I it's been a long time coming, but you know, Churchill said that governments will always do the logical thing once they've exhausted all the other alternatives.
You can't miss when you quote Churchill, that's for sure. Thank you, Jerry. It's great to see you again, and someone who has been really tireless in this advocacy. Kevin, let me ask you. Jerry talked about the need for the rail freight tunnel, but one of the things that he also brought up, though, is the logistics supply chain and how critical it is that cargo move quickly into both a regional and then a national supply chain. And what are the implications of that for either job creation, but then correspondingly, the difficult issues of land utilization east of the Hudson River in terms of warehouse space and the capacity to handle the amount of cargo that these large forecasts are telling us is coming.
Chris, I think, you know, I just glossed over, mentioned very quickly that a lot of the jobs are warehouse and distribution. And there's true, there's a lot of jobs that, you know, the trucks are involved, obviously, then inside you have forklift trucks, et cetera. But reality also, even the warehouse distribution centers are becoming larger, you know, 500,000, you know, million square feet. They're huge. And you see them off New Jersey exit, I forget what it is, 8A, or, but as you go down. And where you know, like Pier 40 here, this was built for a Holland America line at the time in the 1960s. This was a really ultra-modern terminal. They had passenger ships, they had cargo ships, and these were the warehouses, and the, you know, longer-term warehouses, the trucks would come and bring them to someplace else. But, and the cargo went right down to the stores. That model doesn't you know, very rarely does that work. You have a few niches where you can do that, but the ability to put huge warehouse distribution centers with the truck traffic, even if you have rail, siding, et cetera, a certain amount of that's going to go out by truck. And you, when you start looking at doing an environmental impact statement, for example, and you look at what the community resistance is quite often to that, it's really tough to look at not just where the ships discharge, but where those warehouse distribution facilities are. You know, if you go to a Duane Reade and there's a mix of goods, they don't load a container in Singapore with everything that's going to be in that store for that week. So you have to bring it to someplace in this area where they mix and match with other, you know, goods coming from around the world and domestic goods as well. And then they ship it, break it down and ship it out to all the places, you know, in the five boroughs and around. So to be able to have those large enough so that the private sector wants to make those investments, that they can see that they can do that and still be competitive, that Duane Reade can, you know, sell compared to Costco or something, they have to have the economics right. And it's as the scale gets larger, it's a real challenge. And that's where I think, you know, looking at New York Waterfront, you really have to look at what are the niches, and, you know, what are the kind of cargo mix, and where you can take that cargo once it comes off the ship in a way that is, is accepted to the community, and that the government and also the private sector, we talk a lot about government, the private sector has to feel that it's an investment that's worthwhile to make it. Otherwise, you know, government, sometimes you can build things like the fish port someone mentioned that the industry didn't buy into, and you ended up with a white elephant. So you have to be careful. You have to make sure that we have the private sector engaged in any of these projects. And I think New York City EDC has done a very good job on that in a number of cases. Certainly you look at the warehouse distribution job they did with Phoenix Beverage
Company.
So there are areas where you can do that, but you really have to take both the economics and the local politics into account.
I'm going to go back to you, Councilman, to ask you a really tough question. Mm-hmm. Having been someone who worked at EDC and then later at the Port Authority and knows the South Brooklyn Marine Terminal very well, and Jerry's, Congressman Nadler's opinion that you can, in fact, prioritize and juggle these, I think the statistic is that Sunset Park has the lowest park acreage per resident of any part of the city of New York. You've now opened really a beautiful waterfront park down at Bush Piers, but this is, to get there, you have to walk across 3rd Avenue, you have to walk across 2nd Avenue, you have to walk across 1st Avenue. And now we're proposing the idea of wrapping around that park a fairly industrial activity. To what extent is your community going to be torn between, one, a major priority for jobs, and at the same time, a major priority for the greening of the waterfront and park access? And how do you, inevitably, as an elected official, have to balance those? And how do you see that going?
Thank you. That's the question. I think this question is going to define my time as a council member for the next 8 years, without a doubt. These are difficult questions, of course. I think about three things. One is heavy education for the community itself. I think I was at a zoning 101 question or workshop last night, and there were a lot of just good questions that were coming from community members that had lived there the whole time, their whole life, and never really been across Third Avenue. And so there's a lot of demystification of the work that's happening that needs to happen. So we need to educate the people before they can walk into rooms and offer a suggestion or a recommendation. And that's something that we're committed to. So that's one, educate the people. Two, I think I believe that we can actually solve this problem in a real way that offers some design solutions that have yet to come to fruition. And this is where we're working with the Economic Development Corporation, who again has really kind of shifted thinking and should be applauded really for thinking about how we make this community whole. They're bringing amenities to BAT Pier 4 that have not existed before to kind of increase the number of acres and space for people to recreate. They're going to be designing and constructing a second entrance to the park, because there's only one entrance on 43rd Street. And so they'll be designing that and bringing the community into that process so that they can understand it and appreciate what it's going to take to be able to go over the rail that we haven't even talked about in Sunset Park that had a huge investment by the city and really has rail, in all the city, this is a very unique space where you have rail connected to maritime. And that's something that is of value regionally. And Sunset Park needs to understand that that's a huge asset. And so these are things that need to just continue to be of priority, educating the people, having agencies committed to making that promise, and solving some of the design questions. But back to your first thing in the introduction, I think is absolutely right. The past cannot define our future. Our future is somewhere that we haven't yet thought of. And the way we get there is to get the table large enough so that multiple stakeholders can help design this. And I think we can through a lot of designing, get out of these hard conundrums.
Great. I think one of the questions, going back to the captain, is that people are going to want to hear about is, you know, where are your students coming from? What are the demographics? You know, what do you see as your feeder pool of people here in New York City? And 36 is a great number because I'm sure they're getting incredible attention and effort, but for this group here, we'd like to think that could be 360 people. And where would, if you could grow, you know, where would be the communities that you'd like to reach out to?
Well, Kingsborough Community College is part of the City University of New York. So the first place that we draw from is from throughout New York City. And quite frankly, for the number of spaces that we have and for our capacity, most of our students come from around New York City. I often tell the story of I often go into high schools to recruit students. And by the way, the majority of our students starting our program are not recent high school graduates. They've probably have been, well, the typical student will come into my office and said, I want to come into your program. I remember when you came into our high school 3 years ago and spoke about the program. And I wasn't sure what to do. And I've been working at this job and that job and odd jobs for the past 2, 3, 4 years. And I've decided that I now really have to focus and get a career. And I always found that interesting. And I want to start your program. And that's the typical student in our program, probably 21, 22 years old starting. Do we have some recent high school graduates? Yes. But most of them have been employed in other jobs, but have always had an interest in the water. So that's where our students come from. Do we have students that come from Long Island? A few, but anyone who's driven to Bell Parkway on a regular basis knows that that's probably, that is truly a labor of love, and they are fully dedicated to their education if they come to Kingsborough on a regular basis. I mean, I've had students that come from Suffolk County.
Clay raised the issue again. The privilege of being the moderator. Let me ask a follow-up question and then come back to Clay. Raised the tough issue in terms of the challenges in Baltimore and what we've seen in terms of lack of economic opportunity being the tinder, if you will, for the response to that terrible tragedy. What's the demographics in terms of people of color applying for this program for you, Captain?
To me?
Yeah.
Oh. That's a great question. You know, I'm often asked the question, do you have, how many women do you have in the program? and you know, what type of race and breakdown do you have? And I would say that we have a mixture of everyone from the city. You know, at one point, let's be very frank here. At one point, the waterfront jobs, on the water jobs, they were white middle class jobs. Okay.
Exactly.
Right. Much to the credit of the employers in New York Harbor, that is no longer the case. I see the employers in New York Harbor making an effort to hire minorities, making an effort to hire women. I'm often reminded of my students do internships in their last semester, and I meet them each Friday at different locations and different sites. And I had this Janine Smith, was maybe 95 pounds, maybe 5 foot tall. And I bring it down to one of the tugboat companies that day to do her internship. And the whole crew is looking at me going, yeah, right, this guy, yeah, ha, 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 look at her. And at the end of the day, when I went back, they came back to me and says, you know, that girl knows how to run a boat. And I said, that's why I sent her down here. So the demographics have changed. We do have minorities coming into the program. We do have women. I don't care who you are. If you want to come to our program, you want to train, if you're serious, and that's one of the things, too. We start 36. We don't graduate 36.
Oh.
I graduate maybe 24, maybe a few less. Because some people come in and say, you know what? I thought this was a good idea, but I didn't realize I had to go out in the middle of January and February and do this. Or I didn't realize I had to go into the engine room. And I tell them, you know, I've got a number of degrees. I'm doing this over 40 years. I still go down in the engine room and muck out the bilges at times. So once some of them do that, they change their minds. But as far as the demographics are concerned at this point, if you're a New York City high school graduate, we'll take you.
Great. Thanks.
I think we've got something here, if I may follow up on what the captain just said. There are a number of students here today, and we didn't mention them, from the New York Harbor School, which is now relocated onto Governor's Island. I want to acknowledge that they're here. It's very greatly to the credit of the city and the Board of Education here, that we do have a harbor school up and running. And it is focused. It started in Bushwick a few years back. Some of us can remember going to graduations and other class attending the meetings there in Bushwick. That is an example of how you tap into inner city youth and a broadly based representative demographic. We're ahead, frankly, of the rest of the country, with the exception of a few places like Philadelphia and oddly enough, Toledo, Ohio, where this is being done. But it's very important to note that there are, in fact, we do have a feeder system. It may be an embryo, it may be the beginning, but it's a real feeder system, as the captain pointed out. And that's very, very much to the advantage of the greater New York port area.
Great. And I'll just add and say that this doesn't just happen. This isn't an organic thing that happens. We need to really commit resources. We need to commit policy. The Harbor School is looking for an expansion. We're talking about this in Red Hook and the Governor's Island. There's a lot of work here that needs to happen, and the city needs to commit. And this doesn't just happen overnight.
No.
And
yes, as someone who was there at the Bush Terminal in 1997, when the first time was down touring it, the number one challenge in those days was feral dogs who were running through the abandoned warehouses. And we've come an awful long way from that. One of the things we've also heard a lot about today is the advent of the post-Panamax vessel and the size of those vessels, and the amount of cargo that's potentially dropped on the ground is now reaching levels that we never really thought possible. As the congressman said, at one point a large vessel, Kevin, was 7,000 to 8,000 TEUs. We're now talking about ships that are going anywhere from 14,000 to 20,000, even 20,000 TEUs. And again, Kevin's model of economic efficiency. Is there within the Brooklyn waterfront the capacity for redistribution of that amount of cargo in a single move from a large vessel, or are we in fact talking about a very niche market which is servicing a particular type of vessel at a particular time with a routed cargo that's been almost pre-programmed to make the cargo coming off sorted and thought of in a way and industrialize in a way that, that works on the Brooklyn waterfront. Kevin, I was just wondering if you had any thoughts along that.
Yeah, and I think, you know, to touch a bit on what Carlos says, and Chris, what you had said about competing interests, and Congressman Nadler mentioned, you know, that, you know, wanting to keep a certain amount of, you know, the mileage or linear footage of the shoreline available for, you know, heavy maritime use, and not have it all be condos, and, you know, which has very short life from an economic development perspective. Once you have the construction, you know, then it's, you know, you need to have jobs. Yeah. On the other hand, you have these competing interests, and if you look from the economic side, the cost of every time you take handle a good, when you take it off a ship, put it on one truck, and that's why all the mechanization that I've touched on with container terminals, where they really try to minimize now the human, you know, touch, just get it so it goes, because each time you have a set of hands involved in touching it, your cost goes up exponentially. And as I said, nothing earlier, nothing goes right from the ship right to the, you know, to the grocery store or Duane Reade, or the, you know, and to get that large volume, if you're having, you're, if you're talking tens of thousands of tons of cargo coming off one of these ships, you know, say if you put 23 revenue tons, say, you know, cubic meters per container, and you think of what that is in a shelf in a store, and you put that, multiply that by 20,000. You know, God knows where you're going to put that, anywhere near the Brooklyn waterfront. And, you know, and then break it down, resort it with other cargo coming in. It's not just those, you know, 20,000 containers, and not that a full ship discharges 20,000 at a time. But you start looking at these kind of volumes and where you're going to take it and put it throughout that chain. One option is to say some of it comes off in Brooklyn, gets automatically reloaded to go back to New Jersey or where the other warehouses are. But those handling has a cost. And the issue will be who's willing. Can, if you do those extra handlings, will it allow the shipping line to be able to be profitable in doing that? And if New Jersey became, you know, ungodly expensive, then maybe the economics would dictate. I think right now the economics don't favor that, but, you know, the truck traffic is horrendous. You have also pollution. We haven't talked about the, you know, the environmental consequences of all the truck traffic. So when you start taking some of these costs, you know, that certainly ties into that. But at the end of the day, you're going to have to see a shipping line and some maybe some major importers, a Walmart or something, say, yes, we want it here, and we are able to be economically competitive. If not, then it's really, you know, it's a wonderful, fancy idea, but it's not necessarily something that's going to fly in practice. And then it has to also accommodate, in Brooklyn specifically, you know, the aspirations of that community who may not want to wait, you know, 20 years or 30 years of the economics dictate that.
Right. Clay, you mentioned this, which is short sea shipping, which for some reason I find very difficult to say. And I think it's a really intriguing opportunity for Brooklyn. And the notion is that there's an enormous amount of traffic which is moving north-south along I-95. And as I-95 gets increasingly congested, that trucking economics reaches potentially a tipping point where assembling that cargo on a fast vessel traveling from Savannah, perhaps, up into New York and then on up into New Haven and Boston might be a market, one, to for the maritime academies, but also as a ways of congestion mitigation and also maintaining a right size shipping in a location in the Brooklyn waterfront. Would you care to comment on that idea?
Yeah, I would, as a matter of fact. Thank you. One of the things that we haven't touched upon is the environmental cost of being, as Congressman Nadler very well pointed out, dependent on trucks. These trucks are diesel trucks, and regardless of what they say on the side of them or the bumper stickers that they have in the back, they are not only big gas guzzlers, but they're big major polluters. Shipping is way ahead of the game in that we're now in the midst of a tremendous transition that has not been picked up in the public media, but is happening as we speak, which is the changeover to propulsion by means of liquid natural gas. This is already beginning on the West Coast with the so-called Jones Act, U.S. flag trades between Tacoma and Alaska and between Florida and Puerto Rico. Within the next 15 years or so, you're going to see most of the tugs that are not, you know, very, very new tugs being replaced by gas-propelled trucks, tugs. This means that which is much cleaner, a much cleaner burning fuel, a much cheaper fuel, because gas is produced in enormous quantities here in the lower 48 states. It does not require refining. It's liquid natural gas. That will make a create a real economics of scale situation where I think that you will see a lot more cargo being moved, certainly between developed ports, such as Port Newark, Port Elizabeth, New Haven, Bridgeport. New Haven, by the way, most people think there's nothing there but Yale. New Haven actually is a major port for the import of steel cargoes, processed steel, mostly from overseas. Boston, that will take, we have to take pressure off the I-95. The I-95 is an unmitigated disaster. The state governments seem to be incapable of doing anything about it, and probably no one can do anything about it. So yes, I do think short sea shipping is very much something that's going to come back. It has been promoted by the Maritime Administration, as you know, in Washington for years. But the federal government, as in so many transportation aspects, has been ineffectual in focusing on the need to get going on it. It was invented 200 years ago. We've got tugs, we've got barges, but nothing is being done, really, to push it forward.
Great, thank you. We're running out of time, so as a courtesy, I will allow the councilman the last remarks here. And my question to you is, you know, I think about the challenges that you face in your community, and my question is, how can MW, the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance, which is now the Waterfront Alliance, help you in that planning process to bring the kind of input that you say very graciously EDC is beginning to consider? How can we help you in that effort?
Well, I just want to say that the MWA has already been so helpful in this last year to bridge my gaps in information. You know, I was born in the desert in a lot of ways, and so in El Paso, Texas. And so I think that I in a lot of ways represent this gap of opportunity that a lot of New Yorkers can begin to take the leap with you so that the community, the MWA community, can feel connected to all parts of the city, and that there could be some alliances really created beyond the waterfront and in an upland, and so that we can all be on the same page and move forward. So more ways that we can connect to people that don't think about the waterfront, because we need everyone to think about the waterfront in a way that is going to be supportive for some of these pieces. A lot of the things that we talked about today are going to require political force. And so really thinking about it in those ways is going to be important. Allowing the Economic Development Corporation and the Port Authority and other agencies that kind of hold the keys to some of this, to let them know how important it is for us to think about these things differently, and to bring more people to the table, to bring yourselves to the table. If you're advocates for the Harbor School, if you're students, if you're new employees, all of you bring a different piece of the voices. So maybe we can think about the next conference as a way to think about how we can measure that success. How have we grown the advocacy to people outside that don't use the waterways, but can maybe think about using them and advocating for them? And I think that's the way we get somewhere. And political power is real.
Great.
In a big way.
Well, thank you, panel. I appreciate everybody appearing today and the thoughtful remarks you've had. We end. Thank you very much.